Good afternoon. I'm Warren Hoag, IPI's Senior Advisor for External Relations, and I'm happy to welcome you to this Global Leader Series event focusing on the upcoming selection of the person who will become the next Secretary General of the United Nations. IPI is presenting all the official candidates for the post individually here in the Trygve Lie Center. And our guest today is Christiana Figueres, the former Executive Secretary of the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. You in the audience have her full biography in your papers, but for the sake of those of you who are following this via video, let me note briefly that in addition to the post I just mentioned that Ms. Figueres held for 6 years leading up to the historic Paris Agreement last year, she has served in the Costa Rican Foreign Service as Director of the International Cooperation in Costa Rica's Ministry of Planning, as Director of Renewable Energy in the Americas for the Organization of American States, and as Founder and Executive Director of the nonprofit Center for Sustainable Development in the Americas. As with the other candidates who have appeared here, we have asked her to speak for 15 minutes, and then we will go directly to the question and answer period with you. So please join me in welcoming to IPI the former Executive Secretary of the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change, Christiana Figueres.
Good afternoon to all of you. Thank you very much for your kind invitation, Warren, and thank you to IPI, not only for inviting me, but actually for really heeding the call that came from so many people in this city and elsewhere for broader participation and more exposure of everyone to the very, very important process of selecting the next Secretary General. Thank you very much to IPI for contributing to that process. Today I would like to start, I think, where we know we all are, at the 70th birthday of the most, from my perspective, the most important organization in the world doing the most important jobs, plural, in the world. And an organization that has, over its 70-year period, has had very clear successes and achievements, and also still facing many challenges. It is an organization, I would argue, that is strained by at least three new factors that we're facing here at the beginning of this new century. The first is the increasing aspirations and mandates that are coming to rest onto the lap of the United Nations. That is, I would argue, a good thing. If we had an organization today that 70 years after its birth, it is still dealing with the original mandates, we would have an organization that is, by definition, completely irrelevant and obsolete. I would argue that the fact that there are more and more aspirations, humanity's aspirations, and more mandates that come to the UN is actually a measure of success of the UN, because it is straining to catch up with that, but it does really mean that there is a role to be played by the United Nations as we, as humanity, continue to improve the way that we work and treat each other. The second strain that I think that we're under is the increasing gap between the financial resources that are allocated to the organization and those mandates, because I've already established we have more and more mandates that are coming onto our lap. Good news, not such good news that particularly right now we are clearly in a moment of financial stress for everyone. And hence there is an increasing gap between the mandates, the aspirations, the expectations, and the financial resources that are available to the institution. And the third factor of strain is the increasing complexity of the issues that we are dealing with. There is no comparison. There is no comparison of the complexity of the issues that we're dealing with today with the complexity of the issues that we dealt with last century. And that, of course, in a context in which this organization lives in a world that is increasingly multipolar, not the situation in which we were born 70 years ago, increasingly interconnected. Just take a look at your everything that you have in your pockets and the expectation of immediate response. You mean you haven't responded? I sent it to you 3 seconds ago. And that's the attitude that we have toward organizations as well. Understandable, because we're increasingly interconnected. But perhaps the most important change of this century is not just that we're increasingly interconnected, but we are increasingly interdependent of each other. And why are we increasingly interdependent? Yes, because of increasing demographics, but also because that increase in demographics and the increasing growth that we have had in economic development, not consistent across countries, but certainly globally, we have had consistent growth in economic development, has put an enormous strain on natural resources. Arguably, we have reached planetary boundaries on most issues, and that then causes us to be more and more interdependent. Hence, what could have been perceived as the loss of one and the gain of another in the last century is no longer the case. We are now at a point in which we either all figure out how to win together, or we're all definitely going to lose together. Hence, a renewed mandate and a renewed meaning for the United Nations, the only organization in the world that really has universal representation and universal voice and vote. This multipolarity, interdependence, and interconnection means that we are no longer in the world in which we had a single tool that we could throw at a problem. That used to be a reality. That is no longer the case. We are now expected to grow in our multivalent capacity, where our multivalency needs to grow exponentially. What do I mean by that? We need to be much more inclusive of each other as countries, of each other of sectors, civil society, the private sector. Everyone needs to be much more included. We're at a point in which, unless we collaborate, there's very few things that we can do individually, whether you're a country, a sector, a company. Unless collaboration is the mode of work, the modus operandi, very difficult to move forward. And secondly, there is, and perhaps that is the greatest challenge for the UN, there is the challenge of integrating everything that we have thought of as being parallel tracks that now needs to be integrated. And that is fundamentally true across all the topics that are under the wing of the United Nations, but it is especially true on peace and security, and that's where I would like to start. So where are we on peace and security today? Well, we're at the point in which we're having a larger presence of peace and security. We went from just 15 years ago from an average of 1,200 uniformed personnel to an average of 10,000 today. We're having much longer peace operations everywhere. We went from an average of 2.5 15 years ago today to an average of 6.5 years. We are working increasingly, in particular in the last 2 or 3 years, in much more volatile environments that are being deployed in increasingly politically unstable environments, hence a huge threat, not just for the populations, but also for our uniformed personnel. And furthermore, as though that were not complicated enough, we're now working in sites in which we have increased remoteness and increased difficult access, meaning the difficulty of getting there, but also the expense of operating in those scenarios. So what does this all mean? It means that we have to develop and learn to work much smarter. And what do I mean by much smarter? I mean that we need to work much, much smarter, at least at three different levels. The first level, we must be much, much smarter at restoring peace when that has been lost. First level. And how do we do that? Well, I do think that we have been in a process, but there is space still to improve a lot the way that we harness the full potential of the analysis and diagnosis that we can do. We are still plagued by isolated efforts of political analysis, situational analysis, human rights analysis, humanitarian analysis that are sort of in pockets, and that if we could A, take that analysis to the next level of understanding and of depth, and B, harness the integration of that analysis, we would be in a much, much better place with respect to diagnosis of what it is that we are facing in peace and security in each of the scenarios. And that would then take us to the integration of all of those different aspects where we need at the strategic design and planning stage, way before we're in the field, way before that, where we're making the strategic planning and design, we need to be integrating the political understanding, the human rights understanding, the humanitarian, certainly deriving much more information from our country teams, from peacekeeping forces, from the field support, from safety and security, all of that to give the Security Council a much, much better analysis and certainly much deeper understanding of the options that the Security Council has. So that would be the first step. The second step then would be, how do we calibrate better? How do we not just calibrate at the beginning when the mandate is being given, but rather a continual calibration of the mandate versus the support that is being offered to this personnel, both financially as well as in equipment, and a continual calibration that the situation to which we are responding remains the same as the original situation that we diagnosed. Because we're in a world of exponential change, and more likely than not, the situation that we had diagnosed and that we had planned for will change very quickly, and we put our troops in the situation of responding to a challenge and a diagnosis that is no longer current. So, recurrent reporting and constant calibration. And then, of course, huge opportunity to strengthen the partnerships with regional and sub-regional partners that we have that include quite a few, the African Union, the European Union, the Arab League, certainly huge efforts to be made there to strengthen that that partnership, the Organization for Islamic Cooperation, ECOWAS, IGAD, the list is long. But we should not leave any effort unused to strengthen the relationship and the partnerships with those organizations that are in the field, that understand the situation much better, are there, can give us the more current information, and certainly the cultural understanding and the political understanding that is very, very difficult to replicate if you're sitting in New York City. So, absolutely clear there of the need to strengthen partnerships. So that would be getting smarter at restoring peace if lost, in those situations. The second level where we need to be working much smarter is in safe, and you notice I'm walking back, okay, I'm walking back first, those situations in which peace has been painfully lost, now I'm walking back to those situations in which we need to safeguard peace before it is lost, because that is equally as important, and that would fall under the category of immediate prevention and de-escalation of conflicts. And how can we work smarter there? Well, first of all, I think we might fall under some, in some cases, into the immediacy. You know, when you have a hammer, everything looks like a nail. And when we have fantastic uniformed personnel, everything looks like, let's send in some uniformed personnel. Well, maybe not that quickly. Maybe we really need to emphasize the primacy of politics, the primacy of diplomacy. That is the strongest tool of the United Nations. If there's one tool that we have, it is our capacity to do multilateral diplomacy. And that is the first that we should be deploying, and certainly one area in which we would do well to invest further in the mediation capacity that the UN has been building up and where we have very successful mediators, but honestly, we need many more of them. Second piece on safeguarding peace before it is lost, strengthening the regional political offices that we already have, particularly in Africa, and in fact, even considering, as some have already put forward, the creation of at least one more in Africa, because experience shows that that has actually been incredibly helpful in de-escalating conflicts. And then how do we use our country teams that are in the field? How do we increase the capacity that they have to not just do the work, let me put it this way, the work of the other agencies and funds, but also to calibrate their lenses to pick up the early warnings where there are systemic human rights violations, where there are confrontations that cross different ethnic, religious lines, because those are the telltale signs of a potential escalation and conflict that is coming, and we should be harnessing that information from them much quicker. And then, of course, I would not be able to stand here in front of you if I did not mention that we are not using 50% of the potential intelligence and capacity that we have in this world, namely, come on, guys. Thank you. Yes, exactly. I'm not sure if we're 50 or 51%, but, you know, somewhere there. You know, we just such a waste from society's perspective, such a waste that we're not investing more into what women can do, in particular in safeguarding peace. To be complemented, of course, by youth and religious leaders. Are we actively reaching out? And there I really speak from deep experience, and I am so grateful for the leadership that religious leaders gave to the Paris Agreement. It's, you know, counterfactual to say, could we have done it without that? Counterfactual, but in any event, very, very clear leadership and very important, and one that we should be smart enough to harness also in this area. The third area where we should be working smarter, and I'm walking back, is not just on restoring peace if it's lost and safeguarding peace before it is lost, but seeding peace. Seeding the seeds, planting the seeds of peace today for peace tomorrow. Planting the seeds of more sustainable development, of better respect of human rights. And that, I would say, falls into the category not of immediate prevention, but of systemic long-term prevention. Equally urgent, just because it is long-term and just because the fruits and the flowers we will see later on doesn't mean that it's not urgent today, because if we don't do it today, we will not be able to harvest it tomorrow. And there, that falls into the whole package of what are we doing on SDGs, how quickly can we implement them, certainly how quickly can we implement the Paris Agreement, and I'm happy to answer some questions about that. As you can imagine, I could go on and on about that, but I won't. Just a few, you know, data points for all of us to remember. We have approximately, please don't hold me on the 000 number, but just easy number to remember, we have 1 billion people in this world who live on degraded lands. 1 billion people. We have 1 billion people who have no food security. We have 1 billion people who have no water and sanitation security. We have 1.3 billion people who have no access to power and energy. Well, if that is not a tinderbox, these people who live without future, without hope, that is a completely unsustainable situation. And let me just argue to you that that is A, morally unacceptable to any of us. be economically counterproductive because we have 1 billion people that are not contributing to global society. And C, it is socially unstable, at least, if not explosive. So it is very clear that that is a piece of work that we need to understand needs to be done, and that is part of the macro integration of all of the agendas of the United Nations, because we have to avoid for that ground to become the breeding ground of future conflicts. So to summarize for you, not only do we have to be much, much smarter on immediate prevention, we also have to be much smarter and much more strategic about systemic prevention. I do believe that that we are now at a very important moment in the history of mankind where we are faced actually with a choice. And it is a choice, because we all choose where we put our energy and what we work for. And there is a choice here between continuing to spiral down into all of these negative issues that are mutually reinforcing and that take us to increased hopelessness, conflict, violence, extremism, more migration, on and on and on. Or we have the huge opportunity that takes work, it's not easy, but frankly, what other moral choice can we make to turn that around and construct intentionally, because it won't happen on its own, but intentionally construct an upward spiral of mutually reinforcing factors that can take us to a much, much safer, more stable, and more peaceful century, which is our responsibility for all of us who are here right now. I would just finalize by drawing for you in your mind's eye an arc. So think of an arc that actually is drawn across sustainability, stability, and security, the three S's. Draw an arc across those three S's, sustainability, stability, and security, and understand that that is the challenge of the United Nations, to be able to understand that arc, to be able to understand that all of these things affect each other and can positively reinforce each other, and to be able to do that not just conceptually, but also operationally. Thank you.
We're going to go directly now to questions and answers. If you raise your hand, I'm going to call upon three people at once, and then we'll take those three questions and move on to three others. So gentleman in the blue shirt back there first. Number two will be, I can't see you, but I see your hand, right? Number two, and a third right there, okay? So, and would you please introduce yourself? I know who you are, but they don't.
Bill Blakemore, 45 years with ABC and now recently gone freelance, still associated.
Bill, hold the microphone a little closer.
My name is Bill Blakemore, 45 years with ABC News in New York and now recently gone freelance, so I'm not officially, but still associated with ABC News. And I'm a correspondent focusing for 14 years on global warming. Interviewed the ambassador in Durban. Ambassador, in recent years there's been increasing talk about the need to update the Security Council. The structure of it, or possibly the rules of it, or both. Do you think that's necessary? If so, do you have a vision for what it should be? And in any case, if so, how do you think it should be done? What would be the right way to update the Security Council?
Okay, the second question.
Hello, Rachel Ford from Global Network of Women Peacebuilders. My question is about gender equality. Could you tell us what you've done in your previous work to promote gender equality? And if what is your plan, if elected as Secretary General, to advance the implementation of UNSCR 1325?
Excellent. And then the third, yes. The microphone's coming at you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Figueres. Maria Josami, interning at the Department of Political Affairs. And as an environmentalist, I would like to ask you, what role do you believe that the United Nations could play in assisting less developed nations in dealing with the impact of climate change, as many of them are geographically located at a disadvantage to be able to deal with the effects of global warming? Thank you.
You can take those three.
Well, thank you for those three questions. On reform of the Security Council, you know that is not the purview of the Secretary General. So I won't surprise you with any answer out of that. And you also know that everybody agrees that there is a historical reason why we have the type of Security Council that we have, and everybody agrees that it can and should be updated, but nobody agrees on how. And so we have five different issues there under reform of the Security Council, and I would say rather a slow process of digestion there, where we now have at least an oral decision that is at least on the books, and that is as far as we have gotten. But you know as well as I, or better than I, that is not the purview of the Secretary General, and that is in the hands of member states. On gender equality, I would like to say two things about that. The first is that I have the fundamental belief that we would reach gender equality anyway, because humanity is increasing its self-performance. Our problem and our impatience should be about reaching gender parity before and accelerating that as quickly as possible. So it needs intentionality. The direction is clear, right? We would get there anyway, but we certainly want to get there sooner rather than later. And the reason why I say that is because you can see that compared to where we were 2,000 years ago, we're definitely better, but we certainly don't want to work and wait another 2,000 years, okay? So we've invested in what I call the male leg of society, and we've been hopping along pretty well. But as soon as we invest into the female leg of society, we may be able to have two legs with which we can walk much, much better, or perhaps even run, and we would have a much healthier balance. With respect to 1325, you know what I really, and you know better than I everything that is being done there to put that forward, move it forward, both with respect to positions of decision, but also women in peace and security situations where we are disproportionately affected. But what I think is groundbreaking about that is that it really underlines the fact that women, yes, are victims, continue to be victims, and children, women and children, but that we can also be incredible agents of change. So for me, the interesting part about that is, how do you increase the agency of women to be, as I mentioned before in my intervention, to be, for example, peace builders, to be peacekeepers, to be society builders, because that is the role that we have, and we can do very well. On LDCs, honestly, it's very difficult to think of a group of countries that are more disproportionately affected by the negative impacts of climate change. Because they are the least responsible in the past. B, because they are currently, in the present, the least capable to deal with these issues. So it is fundamentally clear that A, the priority in LDCs has to be to support both the financing as well as the access to technology and to expertise on adaptation across the board in all different sectors, but also the huge responsibility that is a global responsibility to mitigate and to bring down emissions. Because that cannot be done by the LDCs. By definition, they're very, very low emitters, and hence there's very little emissions that they can bring down. If they're low emitters, they can't really do much about their emissions. So that is a global responsibility, and that is the purpose of the Paris Agreement, and that is why I am truly grateful that we now have 196 countries, because there's more than here for the UN headquarters, but 196 countries that are truly determined to help each other and to collaborate in the new kind of multilateralism that I'm talking about. This is the Paris Agreement. Take away climate change. What is the Paris Agreement all about? It's about a strengthened multilateralism. It's about a better share of global responsibility. It's about collaborating with each other. And it's about not just collaborating with each other, governments with each other, but inviting the rest of the sectors on board, inviting the private sector, the civil sector, to everybody to contribute. So take away climate change, which it would definitely was constructed to do, but it is the kind of new multilateralism and strengthened multilateralism that I would like to see operating not just for climate change, but for many other issues in the UN.
Excellent. We'll take three more. I have one in the second row here, and the second one in the second row, and then there. Very good.
Hello, Michael Doyle with the International Peace Institute in Columbia University. Madam Ambassador, the successes that came out of the Paris Climate Treaty have been attributed to brilliant diplomacy, including yourself, but also, as you just remarked in your previous statement, to the ability of a scientific consensus to be formed on a reliable basis of objective expertise. You mentioned that as a model for international problem solving. Are there other elements of international problems embodied in the SDGs or elsewhere for which that particular strategy would be potentially useful?
You mean science?
The use of scientific panels as a way to advance diplomacy.
Okay, and then right next to you.
Hi, my name is Ram Chalori, and I'm associated with the International Peace and Reconciliation NGO at the UN. I'm kind of novice to UN elections. The thing that I know, though, the election for the Secretary General is on geographic rotation and primarily decided by the permanent representatives, I think. So what are all the possibilities outside that arena for anybody to aspire to be a Secretary General?
And then the third question with that gentleman there.
Ms. Figueres had another question. You were referring to the increase of the mandate of the United Nations, and you're mentioning that's a good thing, and I would agree with that. In the course of this increase of the mandate, you could see like a portfolio of organizations being established and with sometimes overlapping mandates. And it's not always clear, especially in the development arena, you have all these agencies at the country level, and then the government needs to interact with all these different agencies. Would you have any thoughts with regards to institutional reform when it comes to maybe adapting the organization to this change in the mandate? Any thoughts on the way forward? Thank you.
Okay.
With regard to science-based policy, I assure you that did not come without a lot of work. When I started my work 6 years ago, the relationship between climate science and the climate convention was close to nil. And that was something that I was bent and determined to change, because I do feel that that it is important to have very objective information going into any kind of multilateral process. So I'm actually quite grateful and quite proud of that process that we had over those 6 years. With respect to your question, is it applicable for other issues? Absolutely. And let me just differentiate between two kinds of science. Natural science, if that is your question, definitely natural science needs to have a very, very clear guiding role, at least in all of the negotiations and all of the efforts under the United Nations and elsewhere that have to do with the natural environment. And my sister conventions, biodiversity and desertification, come to mind. Obviously, there the need and that's that needs to be the clarion call for policy to always catch up with science. And science evolves much quicker than policy, always. So policy is always a step behind. Our challenge is to make it only one step behind. The problem is when it is 10 or 20 steps behind. So the other piece to that is social science. Let's not forget social science. So on everything to do with peace and security, social science
is absolutely very, very clear. The understanding of the driving forces of migration, the understanding of the driving forces of pressures of one group of people on another, absolutely important for us to understand. And when we think of science, we tend to fall into the default of only thinking natural science, social science, just as important for any multilateral process. On the question of geographical rotation, yes, there is a sentiment, apparently not confirmed by the results of the first straw poll, that Eastern Europe should be the provider of the next Secretary General. I just want to be very transparent, A, that I have full respect for that sentiment. I understand. Obviously, there has never been a Secretary General from that region, so full respect for that sentiment. At the same time, my candidacy there is not out of disrespect for that, but rather just following the maternal wisdom that I have always provided my daughters, and I like to be consistent in life. I know it's kind of boring, but I do like to be consistent. And I've always told my daughters, it is better in life to have more options than less. So my candidacy is only for the Security Council and the General Assembly to have more options rather than less, and to make, hopefully, a more informed decision. And on the excess of enthusiasm, let's say, we would be in a way worse situation if we didn't have any organizations, be they governmental or non-governmental, that wanted to stand up to the challenge of, for example, implementing the SDGs or human rights or, you know, whatever the challenge at hand is. So first, you know, let us be grateful for the fact that there are that many people who do want to devote their lives for these causes, and that do so very often under extremely difficult conditions, and very, very difficult, both physical and financial conditions. So A, my appreciation and my respect for them to do that. Yes, there is an untidiness, let's say, in that. I frankly think that is a little bit difficult to avoid because of what I argued right in the beginning. We're in a multipolar world. If we were in a world that obeys hierarchy, you know, like the Egyptian pyramids, if that were the society that we had, then we could probably organize that. That is not the world that we live in. And everybody wants to coordinate, but nobody wants to be coordinated, okay? So it's not about, you know, trying to tidy this up. It's about trying to take all of these efforts and take them to the next level through the collaboration of them, through trying to find where are their synergies among them, and where can they help each other to get to the next level of impact.
We'll take three more. I have a particular bias towards all those people who are standing in the back. If any of you raises a hand, I'll call on you right away. In the meantime, we'll go here in the second row, this gentleman, and George there. And do I see a third? Well, for the moment, we'll take these. Oh, I'm sorry. Excellent. And that's a special one, which I'll tell you about in a second. So, one, two, three.
Hi, good afternoon. My question is, you were one of the only candidates during the town hall who would apologize to the international community for the UN's role in the cholera outbreak in Haiti. So what do you think the UN should do in terms of first steps after that?
Excellent. Okay. Yeah, over here, Christina. Okay.
Thank you. George Baumgarten, UN correspondent for Jewish newspapers in North America, as well as for some African and Pan-African publications. My apologies to those who heard part of this question yesterday morning. With all the outbreaks of violence and lone wolf outbreaks and other outbreaks all over Europe, as well as in Asia and elsewhere, I'm increasingly reminded of the lines from Yeats's poem, The Second Coming, where he says, things fall apart, the center cannot hold, the best lack all conviction, while the worst are filled with passionate intensity. How would you speak to this? What do you think is the UN's place in all this? And what would you do from day one in order to deal with this situation? And just as an aside, What is your opinion of the recently announced Palestinian efforts to sue the British government over the Balfour Declaration of 1917?
Excellent. And now we'll go to Hillary, who will bring us questions via Facebook from abroad.
Great. We've actually got a few today, so maybe you can come back to me in the next round. I'll just give you one for now. And we get this question at every event. This is from someone called Alex, and he says, there's a growing movement protesting against the increasing number of unpaid interns working in the UN Secretariat. If you become the next UNSG, how would you address this issue? And we've got some more, so we'll come back to those.
For those of you who are laughing at that question, you probably have been here before. Every single, Ms. Figueres is the 10th candidate we've had here. At every single candidate's event, the Facebook entry, meaning it's young people, has been that question. So.
Good. Well, thank you for that. So on cholera in Haiti, let me first be very clear that obviously we need to let the legal case proceed. And there is no way of shortcutting that or of intervening with that, no desire or anything. That legal case needs to proceed in a very measured way and very careful way until its final outcome, and we shall obviously respect the final outcome. Having said that, let me say that I do feel that there is at least a moral responsibility here, even though the court has not decided that it really was a UN intervention. Just the evidence that is there leads me to feel that I would rather err on the side of apologizing for something that could have been our responsibility than err on the side of not apologizing. And I know that it's an err. It is a judgment call there, but that is the way that that I would tend to deal with that. So A, the apology. B, just as important as the apology. Haiti is the only LDC country in the entire continent of Latin America and the Caribbean. And it has been hit by natural, social, political, economic, devastating impacts, one time over the other, over the other, over the other. What stops us from actually supporting the build out of the infrastructure of sanitation in Haiti so that at minimum we would be able to free Haiti from cholera? That does not solve all the problems in Haiti, but it certainly gets us one step, at least, into closeness with the SDGs. And what would I do about that? You know, I've actually been losing sleep about that since I raised my hand, because when somebody said, you know, would you raise your hand? And my hand went up and I went, wow. First of all, I went, good for you, Christiana, right? Good reaction, because I'm proud of myself for reacting like that out of the clear blue. But then your question comes into being, right? Like, okay, now how do we deliver on that, okay? And I actually have been thinking that it is not impossible, okay? It is not impossible. We can build a coalition of international agencies and private sector philanthropy organizations that I think would be willing to buckle down and do something like that. And it would be a very important opportunity for everyone. So, you know, I can't say that I have the business plan written out, but I do think that it is possible to do that. And on, you know, the difference between passionate intensity and conviction, I have a hard time differentiating between those two. If passionate intensity is empty, then what's the point? And if there's no conviction and if there's no backbone behind that, then I just don't see how it would be helpful. So I would argue actually for both. I think you do have to be passionate in the sense that you have to know what you stand for and you have to know what you're heading for. You can't just, you know, let the winds move you wherever the winds are. There's got to be a direction. There's got to be a clear movement forward and a clear direction of travel. And that for me is dedication. That's passion. That is what, you know, makes me get up in the morning. But it also has to be filled with the conviction of understanding that it is not just about raising your hand, it is also about being able to deliver and knowing how we're going to deliver. And right now, if you all put me in a corner and go, exactly how are you going to deliver on everything in the UN, I'm going to tell you, I don't know. But I do know that we have the collective wisdom among everyone, that if everyone is convened, we do have the collective wisdom to do that. So that is the part of conviction. But passion without conviction and conviction without passion doesn't get us anywhere. And on the interns, wow, a topic very, very close to my heart. Let me tell you that when I got to the climate secretariat, we had exactly 3 interns per year. And I thought, excuse me, we have 3 interns? Yes, because it's complicated. And then, you know, how do you actually train them to do that? And I went, whoa. No. This is, we're going to change this around. And I'm proud to say that when I left, we just, you know, were exploding out of our capacity with interns. And I think we're up to, I don't know, 40, 50, 60 interns, which for a small organization is actually pretty wonderful. Why are interns important? A, because they have much younger brains than we do. And we always learn from young people, always. Just spend 5 minutes with any young person and you will learn. At least you will learn how to turn on your iPhone. and all of these young people, A, they've been exposed to different technologies, but also to different ways of thinking. And they're much less linear, okay? All of us oldies, and I'll be 60 in a week, so I'm very proud of my age, but you know, all of us 60-year-olds, we're so much more trained on linear thinking and on exclusionary thinking, that it's either good or bad, it's either black or white. My experience of young people is that that linearity in analytical thinking is not as prevalent, and there is much more of a capacity to do much more integrative analysis and thinking. So I you know, am a huge fan of listening to young people. Having said that, I also know that when I speak to the interns after they have been with us at the United Nations, at least the agency that I used to run, after 2 or 3 months, what they tell me is that they learned more from those 2 or 3 months than they did in their entire college experience. So frankly, I think this is a win-win. It's a very, very important win-win. We learn a lot from them. They get an incredible exposure to issues that they're privileged to be exposed to. And I'm not sure that we would be able, certainly in the agency that I used to run, and I don't know about here, to be seen whether we would be able to find funding for that. I'm going to answer a corollary question that wasn't posed, but that is equally important, and that is the unfair geographical distribution of interns. Because obviously, if they're unpaid, that means that it is those parents or those systems or those universities or whatever that have the kind of funding that that would be able to support those expenses. That is an issue. And what I did around that one is I went around with my hat and got some voluntary funding that was very, very specifically targeted to female interns from developing countries, and in particular, LDCs and SIDS, because those are the ones that have the most difficulty. So, you know, can that come out of core budget or, you know, no? Can we make an effort to get some, you know, voluntary? I think, you know, creativity is about everything. And I think we could think about partnerships where universities that are highly endowed would endow one student, but they would also partner with another student. I don't know. But I think, you know, it is worthwhile to figure out how do we at least open the possibility for those that don't have the financial resources to come as an intern.
Excellent. Do I see some more hands? Because we have more time. Okay, here in the front row, and gentlemen there. And do I see a third? And then we'll go back to Hillary to get some more Facebook questions. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Jay Pan from the London School of Economics. And I wanted to ask...
From the LSE?
From the LSE, yeah. Yes.
That's what she has. Hold it high.
I wanted to ask you about global drug policy in general.
About?
Global drug policy. Drug policy. So a lot of the scientific community, both the natural sciences and in the social sciences, have called for harm reduction in both the supply side and the demand side as the core principle of global drug policy. I wanted to ask you, what is the UN doing to support this? And secondly, I would also like you to comment on what's happening in the Philippines at the moment.
What is happening?
In the Philippines.
Philippines.
Thank you.
The second question?
Sorry, the Philippines as in South China Sea?
Yes, thank you for all your hard work on the climate change, climate situation. Appreciate that. My name is Bo Magnuson with Connect to Correct. You mentioned about all the mandates that are being put on the UN and funding those mandates is a challenge. What ideas do you have to bridge that gap, to raise more money, to pay for the 17 SDGs and generate more revenue?
And then Hillary?
Great. I have two. I'm not sure how many there were this round. Do you want me to just give one or both of them?
Well, do both and tell us where they come from.
Okay, great. This first question, it doesn't give a location, but this comes to us from VB Giovanni on Twitter. And they asked what you would do to improve the rights and dignity of LGBTQ youth. And our second question comes from Pakistan, and they want to know how you would work to mediate the dispute in Kashmir. Okay. Thank you.
You know, let me be very frank. The drug challenge is one that I have not dug into yet, and let me be very honest about that. I would only be able to give you an answer from my personal perspective, which I don't think is appropriate. I would really want to be able to understand the drug issue, and as you point out, both supply and demand, from a much more global perspective, because I don't think that the approach that I have or the background that I have, which is A, personal, and B, from a national perspective, because I do know what my country is doing on that, is actually the necessary platform to operate here in the UN. So I would like to thank you for that question and say, you know what, I'm going to come back to you when I have an answer, because right now I don't. And I don't like to put out irresponsible answers, but thank you very much. And that includes what is happening in the Philippines, okay? On the SDGs, it's very clear that official development aid is on the decline and that it is going to be completely impossible to pay for all of the SDGs with official development aid. However, because the SDGs are in countries' interest and are very, very much knit in and interwoven into the development planning, thank heavens, development planning of countries, then there is a very good opportunity for what I would call very strategic leveraging of national budgets, part of which will be dedicated to SDGs anyway, but to use those natural resources to leverage other financial resources that can and should come from the private sector. And my experience in climate is actually that we have a growing number of investors and corporations that have understood that there is no profit to be had on a dead planet. That may come as a surprise, but that is actually the case. And hence, for their own business continuity, many of these companies are actually willing and ready and able to make the kinds of investments that will help countries to pursue the SDGs if the policy framework is in place. So, you know, my urgency there is how many developing countries, because that's where it's most urgent and need most support, not that the others are exempted, how quickly can developing countries put the policy framework in place that will attract and secure and maintain the kind of investment that helps the country to pursue the sustainable development goals, including climate, but not limited to climate. on sexual orientation. That is actually a very good example of what I said at the very beginning of increased mandates being given to the United Nations. Please raise your hand if you think that sexual orientation was an expectation put upon the United Nations 70 years ago. 7D. No, I mean, right. So, you know, I've proved.
One answer is the charter only talks about he.
Well, that's true too, but that's a different issue. But the point is, you know, that is a very good proof of a couple of things. It's a very good proof, A, that we are, as a humanity, if we look at the history of humanity and the history of society, we are increasing our awareness of human rights in many, many different sectors and many different areas that were not considered in 1948 with the Universal Declaration. And that's a good thing. B, it's a very good example of that new awareness and that growing awareness and improvement process of humanity coming and landing itself in the lap of the United Nations. It's also, three, a very good example of where the United Nations is still struggling and strained to get to the point of the expectations that are being given to it. Because let's be very frank. There are some member states that are very uncomfortable about that because their feeling is that this is very much against their cultural practices, their religious beliefs. I will remind everyone that cultural practices and religious beliefs are also human rights. Now, can we find a way to accommodate this such that everyone can practice their cultural practices and their religious beliefs without that usurping individual rights of individual people? I think that that is possible. I know that it's not going to happen overnight, but I do think that that is a conversation that needs to be had, and it is part of this conviction that I was talking about before, where because we know that it is possible, because we know that it has to occur, and we have to make it possible. That doesn't make it any more easy, but it is one that we have to pursue with patience, with understanding, with an open ear to all the different views. The moment that you take one side or the other, you have lost the possibility of moving forward. You have to understand all of the different views and be very impartial in opening up the platform for that conversation. And on Pakistan, well, you know, obviously the answer there to that or any other regional issue is, oh my gosh, dialogue, 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 dialogue. What else, you know, that is what the UN does best. You know, you may think, well, that's a waste of time. I don't think dialogue is a waste of time. May I go on record on that one, okay? I don't think dialogue is a waste of time. I think that is where we begin to understand each other. And dialogue, if you enter a dialogue with deaf ears, that is a waste of time. I would agree to that. But if you go into a dialogue with open ears and with an open heart, that is an investment of your time. And it is an investment of the person with whom you're having that dialogue. That is what I think is at the heart of multilateral diplomacy. And that is the most powerful tool of the United Nations. It's very simple. It's about listening to each other with respect and with dignity and understanding that all of us have some need and some interest behind what we are saying and that we have to create the space for all of us to work collaboratively forward.
Excellent. Any more hands? Good in the back, Victor. You know, it occurred to me I just ought to explain, particularly for people who come here often. Normally, I'm asking questions, and before I came to IPI, I asked questions for 30 years as a journalist. We decided at the beginning of this process that to keep complete impartiality on the part of IPI, that I would not ask any questions because it could be interpreted as something that IPI had an interest in, which is why I'm sitting up here silently. But I welcome as many questions as possible because you're the ones to ask the questions, not me on this occasion. So, Victor, and the second one here, very good. You've asked questions in past ones, so I'm glad to see you raised your hand. Start with Victor.
Thank you, I'm Victor Casanova. I would like to ask you to assess the results of the, or your results of the first round of the straw polls, and what are you thinking of doing differently, probably, or which messages are you conveying in the different capitals or permanent missions here to change the opinion of the council members that did not support your candidacy? Thank you.
And then here in... It's coming to you.
Thank you. I'm Anne Marie Carl. I'm with the New York City Bar Association. And you're talking about fundraising for the UN and investments and so forth. There will be none unless you have rule of law. And that is across the board in terms of multi-sector partnering, in terms of investment, development, sustainability, protection of human rights, and so forth. What do you see as the main barriers to rule of law, and how would you overcome them?
I'll take those two.
To the straw poll, it is a first cut. It's a first sense of where the 15 members of the Security Council were at that point in time. Most, if not all, of the people who I've spoken to confirm that it was actually quite surprising. There were a couple of surprises there. A, that the sentiment that we spoke about before about Eastern Europe, at least for my good colleague Antonio Gutierrez, it doesn't seem to be shown on the straw polls. B, that the sentiment about a woman at the leadership of the United Nations also doesn't seem to be shown at the top. And I think those were the two most evident surprises for everyone. With respect to my own rating, I have to tell you, I was somewhere between satisfied and insatisfied. Is there a word for the middle of that? Well, maybe we can invent a word. In any event, I was grateful for the support, fully recognizing that my candidacy was only 14 days old when the straw poll was taken. And the reason for that is that I really wanted to finish my mandate and my responsibility at the climate convention, which finished on the 6th of July at midnight. And then we launched the candidacy on the 7th of July at 8 in the morning. So, you know, losing only 8 hours. Of pause there. Both the Costa Rican government and myself, we knew that that was a risk. We knew that that I had the option of either starting ahead, resigning, or playing both things at the same time, staying at the convention and, you know, beginning to opt for this new option. And I just decided, frankly, that I didn't want to do that. A, you know, if I'm given a job to do, I do it to the end. I don't leave before. And B, if I'm given a job to do, I give it 150% of my time and energy. I don't do two things at the same time, unless it's part of the job description. So that was my choice, and I knew that there was a risk with that. With respect to what am I doing differently, frankly, I'm not doing anything very differently. I have convictions, I have values and principles, I have operating modes of operating that have been with me for years. And I think what I need to do is just be more present, introduce myself perhaps farther to everyone. I'm not changing anything about myself. This is a decision that has to be made by the Security Council and then by General Assembly. And I feel what I'm doing is offering myself as a possibility. If that is the decision of the Security Council and the General Assembly, so be it. And if it's not, so be it. But the kind of leadership that I offer and the kind of skill set and trajectory of strength and multilateralism that I offer is what I bring to the table. So I have enjoyed, I must say, after the over the past 2 weeks, further deeper conversations with members of the Security Council, but also with many other member states, and today with all of you. At the very minimum, I have to tell you, I am having a very good time. You know why? Because I am learning more than any other time. Concentrated, okay? I am on the steepest learning curve, drugs not included yet, but they will be added. But that's fantastic. You don't want to get to 60 years and then say, oh, I've learned everything, right? I mean, if we don't continue to learn,
every single day, then what is the point of being alive? And what is very clear to me is that the challenges remain consistent. The geopolitics remains consistent. This is a different application of many, many of the skill sets and the lessons learned that I had over the past 6 years serving the UN. So I am delighted. And as you know, there is a second straw poll that will be coming now on the 5th of August. So I look forward to that. To the part where I said I was not satisfied, I'm not satisfied, very frankly, because I have very high expectations of myself, okay? And my daughters will attest to the fact that I don't have high expectations of them, although I'm delighted when they perform very well. I have very, very high standards for myself, but I keep that to myself. And you know, when I look at my results there, I wasn't very happy with that. So I am doing the best that I can to improve for me, not for anybody else, but just for me. And I hope that that serves the world as well. And rule of law. Wow, absolutely at the heart of the United Nations, absolutely at the heart. And no less challenging than you know, than anything else that we have. Certainly no less challenging than peace of security. Very, very interlinked, as we know, with peace and security. And again, I would say, you know, a field in which I would like to say that we aspire for perfection. Maybe we do if that is the end goal, but I have to be very realistic and say that cannot be perfectly done right now. What I aspire is to understand what is the baseline that we have right now on rule of law and ensure that every day, every week, every month, every case, case by case, we're actually progressing in our joint understanding of rule of law, because I think the problem is that we don't have a collective interpretation of rule of law. And while we have so many different interpretations, then that sends us in many different directions. So I think the challenge here is how do you bring everyone increasingly over a period of time that is not overnight, it is a process, it is a learning process, it is a listening process, to a collective, a more collective common ground on the interpretation of a rule of law.
Okay, Hillary will have one. If you have one, that's fine. We'll go there first. Well, we've got time. Number one, number two, and then Hillary, you can finish it off with another Facebook question.
Hello, my name's Kate. I'm from Global Citizen. I just wanted to ask a question on behalf of one of our members in the UK. What can be done to protect all the refugee children who are without a country to live in and without education? And can we get a fast-track consensus to place them and get them into education?
And the second question? Very good.
My name is Mauricio Paez Merino, a compatriot of Mrs. Figueres. And my question is the following. We know the current Secretary General often cites that one of the reasons he felt growing up that he would wanted to become a Secretary General was because of his upbringing in war-torn South Korea, and he saw firsthand the work of the United Nations. We have this opportunity today to hear about your current ideas, but I would like to also perhaps ask something about what made you growing up think, if you ever believed or thought that you'd want to be in this position of being a Secretary General. Was there anyone or anything in your upbringing that inspired you to want to be in this position, especially coming from being the daughter of one of the greatest figures, if not the greatest figures of Costa Rican history? Thank you.
And then Hillary, this will be the last question.
Thank you. This question also comes to us from Costa Rica. And it says, tens of thousands of Central American children, specifically from El Salvador, Guatemala, and Honduras, are being deported from Mexico and the USA back to countries where they face violence, lack of opportunity, and human rights violations. What do you think should be the UN's effort to break this cycle and provide better opportunities for Central American youth?
You know, let me take the two, obviously the first and the third question are very related. And I don't think there's any human being alive that is not deeply pained by the plight of refugee children, whether they're Central American or anywhere else. It is one of the deepest injustices, because these children have absolutely no responsibility. They have no culpability, and they are really suffering the worst situations, abuses of human rights, lack of food, lack of home, lack of health. I mean, on and on and on and on. And it honestly rips our heart, right? It really does. Is there a solution to this? I don't think there is an immediate solution, but I do think that what is being beginning to be thought of in terms of a more equitable sharing of responsibility around refugees, the fact that we have 65 million displaced people, 40 of those internal and 20 million already outside of their boundaries. That is more, and most of these are children and women and children. And that is more than we have ever had in the history. And again, another strain on the system. You see how many strains, of the overlapping of the strains. So I am first very grateful for those countries that have opened their doors, especially to children, and have realized that this is, on the one hand, an immediate strain, on the other hand, a long-term injection of more cultural diversity, of more possibilities, and of a richer society. So let us not fall into the default, you know, of thinking that this is only one side of the picture. Yeah, I think it's very important to realize that these are actually potential investments in those countries that are being willing to receive these children and to give them the care that that they need. But that is at a bilateral, voluntary level. Whether we will be able to to advance quickly enough on refugee framework, global framework, I think is very, very urgent. And in that sense, I believe that the two September meetings that are being held here in New York, one on pledging, but also the other on policy frameworks, are I'm very much looking forward to the result of that, because I think that is one step in the direction of a better framework for all of these people who have already lost their human rights where they were at home. They are losing human rights very often on the road to their destination and then at the final destination again. So I look forward to those meetings. But also, let us not fall into the default of thinking that the responsibility of the United Nations is A, to hold a meeting, or B, to write a document. Because that may be the way we operate, but that cannot be the boundary of our responsibility. The boundary of our responsibility goes beyond that. The boundary of our responsibility then has to go to support the on-the-ground reality and ensure that those people actually have a better life. So, you know, withholding a meeting or writing a document, our responsibility does not end there. Mauricio, to your question, thank you very much for referring to my father. I also think he's quite a hero. And as I said to someone today, you know, he's been gone for quite a few decades, but I still have daily conversations with him, with the advantage that he doesn't contradict me anymore. So, you know, it's quite a wonderful relationship now. But I do look up to my father. I do look up to my father, and I believe that both my father and my mother, both of whom were dedicated to public service their entire lives, are the inspiration that I have, and it's sort of the DNA that that most of us, or all of us, all the children, their children carry, all of my siblings, and I think actually that is a huge privilege to have been given a DNA that that really infuses enthusiasm, passion, and conviction about public service. I think that's a fantastic privilege and an honor to be able to have that. And I share with my father not just the dedication to public service, but the moral compass. And that is one that I definitely got from him. And that is one that, to use my own words, although he used different words because he worked at the national level and I've chosen to work at the global level, but it's the same concept. It is my moral compass has always been and will always continue to be not just the protection of the most vulnerable, but actually how do we improve the quality of life of those who are most marginalized, who are most isolated, politically, economically, socially, in many different respects, because it is they who do not have a voice in these halls across the street, okay? It is they who never get the opportunity to issue a directive. They never get the opportunity to participate in any decision, in any policy design. And hence, they need to be given a voice because they are disproportionately affected and need to be equally represented. So my, you know, moral compass is definitely not just the protection, but actually the improvement of the quality of life of those who need it the most.
Before thanking Christiana Figueres for coming here, no, but wait. Before that, I just wanted to say, Christiana Figueres is the 10th candidate we've had here. There are 12. The other two, Danilo Turk and Helen Clark, have given us a commitment that they will come when we can set a date. The commitment to come here, by the way, includes a second thing, which is an interview, which I'll be doing with Christiana Figueres right now, that goes on our Global Observatory website. They're all there now, and we'll add this one in a day or two. Finally, I do want to thank you and say, I think, I'm not betraying the impartiality that we want to show if I say you clearly are not the low-energy candidate in this race. Thank you.